You know, Harvest Moon in the old days was literally for the harvest. The moon was so full and bright, the idea was that you could go on harvesting into the night because the moon shone down and filled the fields. And then, of course, in even more old days, days beyond our reckoning, the reason that they needed that light in the fields was because of the sacrifices you'd have in those fields when the king would spread his blood out on the field, and then the next king would be born. The big guy knew about that. He remembered generation after generation, time after time, the sacrifice being made over and over again, and the way all the celebrants stood, the whole community together, every one of the communities, all spread out across the earth, each like a small bright spot in a vast, unknowable darkness that was the world. But now, the big guy is ashes. He is dead. He is dead and gone, and he is not coming back. And those memories are lost. And who even holds older memories than that, older still before the invention of bread, before there was a harvest, before the ice? In the old times, that moon still hung. It still hung over the world. It's woven itself into all of us. It's woven itself into our cycles, into so much of our biology, everywhere you look. It's like when you look at a bit of programming and you go through it scanning for variables. There are so many places in our chemistry that revolve around that 28, 29-day cycle, shifting slightly every time back and forth and back and forth. There's so many ways that you've written into the stuff of us and of our siblings, the other creatures, everywhere in our biology, our chemistry, everywhere it's written. That's how old it is. And we live here. What are we? We're like soap scum on the outer rim of the bowl of something. We're barely here at all. All of human history, all of it, taken together, every moment we can remember, aggregated together, is nothing. Is fuck all. It's a fart in the wind, compared to the vast sweep of time that has already passed before. That's what the moon means. We think it's bright and beautiful now because we've done our best to beat it to death. So many lights. When I was growing up in far northern Maine, when you'd go out and the moon was full, you could get to places where it would pierce you. The light would be so bright from the moon, and I know that even there, it's nothing. It's nothing compared to the way it used to be. There's so much light that falls from the sky. Do you know? In a fully dark place, a truly dark place, the Milky Way itself casts shadows. And the moon? The moon, when it is as full and powerful as it is tonight, where it's so powerful that even you in New York City, even you are Twittering and Facebooking and saying, oh my God, there's a moon coming. It's a moon, it's a moon. Very, very excited. Something to post a status update about. It's very exciting. Because if not this, then what? The sandwich you had at lunch. An infographic someone sent you. An adorable series of pictures of rockers playing dogs instead of musical instruments. That one is really good. If you haven't seen it, it's really, really good. And you will, that's how we're all interconnected, right? Like right now you're logging that in your mind. In your mind you're saying to yourself, I'm gonna have to go look for that. I'm gonna have to look for the rockers playing the dogs. I hope David Bowie is playing a schnauzer. That would be amazing. And it is amazing. You should definitely look. But you're logging it now and you'll do it later, and that becomes our communal experience. But once the moon, the heavens, these things were our communal experience, the nature. And then we did what we could. We did what we could to stamp it out. We did what we could to kill it. We wanted to kill it. Of course, now we celebrate it. Now we're like, oh, I hope we can get back to nature. I really want to get back to nature this summer. I just, you know, we didn't, this last summer, we didn't get out as much to nature. And so sometime this fall, maybe. I just want to get some nature, you know, like a box of it. And just kind of like stick my hands in it a little bit. Maybe over a weekend. Kind of feel it around and then let it go. But of course, that's not how nature works. The whole reason we try to fence it out is that it's uncomfortable and destructive, and it is larger than we are. And if there's anything hairless apes hate, it's things that are larger than they are. They do everything they can to pretend we are the largest things in the world, to ignore those vast things standing above us, beyond the firmament, to ignore what we already know. I mean, look at you, here. We're all having this conversation on this beautiful night with the moon outside. We're all acting as if we are not fucked. We're all acting, as far as I can tell, as though the ice caps are not melting. And they are, they're melting. We're fucked. We are most assuredly fucked. But everyone's very human about it. So we say to ourselves, well, what can I really do about that? What can I really do about that? I've already signed up for that green energy thing, those people with the clipboards. I'm totally doing that. And I'm voting for progressive candidates who use the right buzzwords. And if somebody posts something from someone on Facebook and it says something really obnoxious, I'm like, no, I'm against that. I'm doing all that. I am doing my part. I am doing my part. I mean, what would you have of me? And that's an excellent question. Because that's the question that nature asks us. We ask nature, what would you have of me? And what nature says back is, I don't care. I don't care. You're a soap scum on the edge of a bowl. If you make the temperature rise a few degrees and you perish from this earth, if you exterminate the biosphere so that 60, 70%, oh, try 80% of the species die, I don't care. I have all the time, all of it. I will be here when you are dust. When your dust is dust, I will endure. I will be here when you have been forgotten. If you do not work out, life will go on and we will work without you. We never cared about you. That's what the mountains say. That's what the rivers say. That's what the forests say in their deep language. That's what the stars say when they stare down at us. And that's what the moon says. That dead, inanimate hunk of rock that orbits us, shining down on us. That's